Yeah, today we'll take a look at glassware. First, we'll start with some common funnels. So here is the separating funnel or separatory funnel used to separate a twin miscible liquid. You watch my video here where I used it to separate kerosene and water, paraffin and water. So another funnel should be this. This is dropping funnel. Dropping funnel used to introduce the reactant gradually to a flask, especially in refluxing, like in the production of acetic acid and other things. You need to use this to drop gradually. That when you want the reactant to be dropping gradually to the reaction mixture, you use this dropping funnel. It has a tap, just like the separatory funnel also has a tap. Then here is this one has broken a bit. This is Thistle funnel. Thistle funnel. This arm has broken. This is two bulb Thistle funnel, very long. You see the usage on the screen, what it is used for. So that's it. Next one, we'll take a look at a flask. The uncommon one here is the retort flask, used for dry distillation. Maybe you can apply it for destructive distillation of coal. So you put whatever you want to distill here, you cover here, you heat it, the distillate comes here. Commonly, you can use some small round bottom flask, some may say it's Kajer flask, to collect the distillate. You can watch my video here on how to use the retort flask to produce conch HNO3, that's nitric acid. So that's it for this flask, retort flask. Then another flask is here should be filter flask, otherwise known as Buchner flask or vacuum flask. This is used for filtration. So this arm or side arm flask, this arm is used actually to apply suction. When you apply the suction pressure, it takes away most of the liquid. So here you connect the tube here, and here is connected to suction. Then here should be the Buchner funnel, that is for vacuum filtration. For vacuum filtration, the Buchner funnel should be placed here. You place whatever you're going to filter here. Then a vacuum pump. This is connected to a vacuum pump. This will make filtration very fast. That's true. So this is called filter flask or vacuum flask or suction flask or Buchner flask. Sideway flask. It's just more like Erlenmeyer flask. Then the next one, similar, are the Erlenmeyer flask. These ones, Erlenmeyer. Named after Emil Erlenmeyer. He manufactured this in 1860. So this is also called conical flask. It can be used in titration. You see the narrow mouth enables you to mix mixtures well inside without the risk of spillage. So it can be used in titration where you add in your acid into the base you measured out. Then the flat bottom flask, flat bottom, not round, please. This is the flat bottom flask. You see what it is used for in the lab. So this is flat, here is round. This one allows uniform heating, so it is used for distillation commonly. Though the one used for distillation is modified as distillation flask, you see the difference. This is round bottom flask, can be used also in carrying out a fountain experiment. The difference is that the bottom is spherical, it cannot relax, it cannot sit well. As you can see, this is standing, but this cannot stand. So you use what we call clay triangle to bring this to a balance. You see the structure of clay triangle here, there on the screen you're watching. So we have another modified form of round bottom flask used mainly for distillation, and that's what we call distillation flask or distilling flask. Okay, so here is distillation flask. The difference is that this one have an arm where you can connect your condenser. Condenser is connected here. You stop here, then you hit here. The distillate follows here through the condenser and you collect it back, but it is still round bottom. But due to this arm, you call this form of round bottom flask a distillation flask, used mainly for distillation. Beaker is common, of course. Beaker is distinguished from flask by having straight side. The side is not slopy at all. Those ones we call flasks have slopy sides, but this is straight cut, more like a cup. Then it has what we call beak. This is what we call beak, or what we call spout, to enable pouring. You can easily use it to turn liquid. So commonly it's used to hold liquid. It's a multi-purpose glassware in the lab. It has many usage. You can use it to contain some chemical reactions. You see the details of the usage there on the screen. So this is what we call the beaker. It has different sizes. As you can see, this is 500 ml. This one should be 250 ml. You even have the 150 or 100 ml. And take note, this is not used for accurate volume measurement. It is not meant for measuring volume, actually. So it's the accuracy is not up to 100% for volume measurement. So why you need accuracy in volume measurement, you don't rely on this calibration. We have the Biurettes. This is the Biurettes. Biurettes is a glass tube, of course. Glass tube with a tap on one end, and it is graduated. Commonly we have 50 ml, 100 ml, 150 ml, depending on usage. For YX students, they commonly use the 50 ml, but the graduation starts from up, down, marking zero. If you watch closely here, this is zero mark, and that's just the beginning. Then when you keep going down, come up here, you see the 50 ml mark. So it is used for titration, to introduce, to add in a known volume, or to add in volume to another measured volume during titration. That's the work of this. Usually has tap, like this one we are using clip here, but some of them may have a tap. Some may use a ball, pipette ball inside here. If you press it, it goes out. Then some may use open tap, similar to the one you can see here, but this one has just the clip. So it's used for titration. Then another thing used for titration glassware are the pipettes. Here are the pipettes. You have different forms of them. So this one is bulb pipette, this particular one, or what we call volumetric pipette. It is used mainly for volumetric analysis, that is titration. It is not all that graduated. It has only one mark. If you watch here, this one marks the level. So anything here is extra, and this is the bulb. That's why I call bulb pipette. Then this is 25 ml volume. It has, this type has two standard volumes, 20 and 25. Over here, this is 20, and here is 25. And the mark here shows 20, then the mark here shows 25. And you hear from here, you can suck with your mouth, you pipette the liquid. Then over here is the graduated pipette. This one is graduated and is commonly used with a pipette bulb. It's purely graduated. It has a mark. If you watch well here, you have zero. You have the zero mark, the 1 cm, 2 cm. Unlike this one that is really just graduated one place, only the end mark is known. For this one, you can measure out any volume you know. So if you are using this, you can't tell me you get 10 ml. No, you can only get about 25. But with this, you can get 10, get 5, get 6, any ml you want. It has different volumes also. That's for graduated pipette. Then we have a smaller pipette. This is pastuer pipette. Now, some people may call it dropper. This is just used to apply. Remember, pipettes act as dispensers. They are used to transfer measured volumes. Use it to measure out volume, then they will hold it till you transfer it. Like this one, if you hold here, the pressure will not allow the liquid to flow out until you go down to the conical flask if you are doing your titration, where you dispense it out. This one, if you use it, if you press here, it sucks in and it remains that way till you press it again. So it's a dispenser. These are pipettes, are dispensers. And then we have other special glassware. It's called Keeps apparatus. I've used this in one of my videos here. Keeps apparatus, I use it to manufacture hydrogen sulfide, you know, the gas that have a rotten egg smell. So you see how it works. You watch that video to understand more about Keeps apparatus. Commonly, it is used for intermittent supply of gases in the lab. This is chamber A, B, and C. Usually, the liquid reactants are occupied in C and A. Then solid is in B, in the middle. Here is where you connect the tube. You just watch that video you are seeing there on the screen. Here on this channel, you will understand how this works well. But I've told you the main usage is for intermittent supply of gas in the lab. It produces and it also supplies. Keeps apparatus. This is Liebig condenser or Liebig condenser. There are different forms in our glasswares part 2. You will see other forms of condenser. So the Liebig condenser is actually used to convert vapor to liquid. You can also use this for refluxing. though it is called Liebig condenser, it can also be used as a reflux condenser. You see the definition of reflux there on the screen, where you need two reactants to remain for a long time so that you ensure complete reaction. Like during the reaction of ethanol with oxidizing agent like the K2Cl2O7, to ensure complete oxidation of the ethanol to ethanoic acid, you need to carry out what we call refluxing, because if you don't allow the two reactants to remain for a long time, the ethanol will only be partially oxidized to ethanol. But when you allow them to remain for a long time, they will be completely oxidized to ethanoic acid. So this is a Liebig condenser used for converting vapor to liquid, and it also can serve as a reflux condenser depending on your connections. Graduated cylinders, these ones are used for accurate volume measurements. Among all the glassware I've mentioned, the main work of this is for accurate volume measurement. The precision and the accuracy is up to 98%, correct? So it have different volumes and sizes. See, this one is very small. This is 10 ml. The highest volume it can measure is 10 ml. Remember, most of these glasswares are actually made up of borosilicate, and they are heat resistant. While this one is 250 ml, you have the 500 ml and 1000. It can be made of glass or plastic, but we wouldn't show you the plastic ones because we said this video is about glasswares. You see the 250 ml mark here is 200, so it's used actually for accurate volume measurement. Over here, this is called where you are watching this. This is YouTube, of course. It sounds funny. You see the usages there on the screen. It's commonly, you can apply it in drying of some gases. You can also use it as a salt bridge to complete two half cells and other uses you see. Then we have the most common, but not all that too common, the test tubes. Okay, over here, the test tubes. This one has broken. You don't work with broken test tubes. So, the test tubes are used actually to observe some reaction and carry out some tests. You say the name is test tube, of course. It's round, spherical down there. So it can allow you observe some reaction because it's transparent. It can be used to contain or carry out some reactions and also for heating. So this thing that's where it sits, where we place the test tube, is called test tube rack. There are different types. You have the plastic ones and also the wooden type, as you are seeing here. Then the bigger form of the test tube, which is used mainly for boiling, is called boiling tube. This one here is boiling tube. So you apply this mainly for boiling, and this is a test tube ring. It's specially used to hold this while boiling. So boiling some or heating something directly on the Bunsen burner. So you can use test tube for minor heatings. Okay. So, and I told you this is a test tube rack, and these ones are test tube. Then this one is a test tube ring or test tube holder. There are different forms you use to hold the test tube for heat. Here is watch glass. Watch glass, you see the uses there on the screen. It has many uses, different sizes. You can commonly understand the use like this. So it's one of the glass where you can use it to cover beaker. Here should be glass rod. You just use this for turning. For turning, where you need mixtures and other uses you can see there on the screen. This is glass rod. So we hope to continue with this video, part two form of it, where you see other glassware like succulent extractor.